Solr is a super fast and open source search engine that is used to sift through massive amounts of data in an instant. When your end users run a search, they expect relevant results to be returned in the blink of an eye. Search engines like Solr give you exactly that capability. Hi, I'm Caleb from Sematext, and today we are going to deploy Solr inside of Docker containers. Since we are deploying Solr on Docker, you are going to need Docker. If you don't know how to use Docker, check out some of our other resources on Docker to get a basic understanding, or just follow along real closely. But first things first, why? Why would we ever want to put Solr inside of containers? And that is a legitimate question. Like all things in life, there are good news and bad news. Bad news first, Solr performs better on bare metal machines. And the good news is that that difference is only like less than 1%. So for some, that might be a deal breaker, but there are tons of advantages. Like, your containers can run anywhere agnostically. These containers don't know and don't care if they are run on a Windows server, a Linux server, your development machine, or some super obscure version of Linux. If it has Docker, it can run it. This alone can streamline development and deployment, which could make it faster than a bare metal machine. Also, Docker limits configuration drifts, and you don't have to worry about over-provisioning an app. Docker shares the underlying kernel, which makes the container easier to use than a bare metal, faster than a VM, and easier to migrate. And here's what I'm most excited about. Kubernetes. Solr just released a new updated version of their Kubernetes operator, and we will have a full review on this in the near future. So be sure to like and subscribe to check that out. With Solr and Kubernetes, there are a lot of automation options here, and it could be super powerful. So let's go ahead and get started. First, we need to talk a bit about Solr's architecture. There are two ways to run Solr, the traditional leader-follow mode and Solr Cloud. The leader-follower mode is very simplistic and limited in what it can do. That's both good and bad. Good because you don't have to coordinate clusters and deal with complex structure, but bad in a sense that it's very simple. It really just depends on what your use case is and what you're looking for. Breaking it down to layman terms, the Solr leader is kind of like a map. It just points to other data storage locations and receives updates whenever a new commit is made. The followers then do a segment replication, updating only the new data that's received, and does all the grunt work. The advantage of using this structure is its simplicity and reliability. For specific or small use cases, this could work well as a one-trick pony. The downside of this system is the live update speed. There is no high availability of writes. If the master goes down, then there is no more writing. You can still do searches and queries, but yeah, when the master goes down, it's kind of frozen. And when you commit anything under 10 seconds, updates are just going to be way too expensive for the leader to do. So in general, if you have a high throughput and you need a lot of read concurrency and you don't mind the low commit rate, it might be worth looking into this structure. Otherwise, let's look at the second structure, Solr Cloud. Solr Cloud is a newer and more reliable structure, but it can also be a bit more complex. It offers high availability, distributed indexing, logging for your transactions, and even recovery when a replica fails. In short, it's super customizable. In most use cases and production environments, Solr Cloud is what you will be using. So with that in mind, that's what we're going to build today. So let's do it. Instead of entering each command individually in the terminal, let's just create a docker-compose.yaml file. I'll put the completed compose file in the description box below. You can go ahead and grab that and use it as a template if you want, or create your own by following along. First, we need to make a file and call it docker-compose.yaml. And then we need to list the Docker version. I'm using Docker version 3.7. And then we need to list our services. Now, because we are using Solr Cloud and not the leader-follower mode, we will also need to download what's called Zookeeper. Zookeeper is a centralized service used to maintain configuration information. Zookeeper is essentially a glorified shared file system, but it's absolutely necessary for Solr to run smoothly. So we will make 3 instances of Solr and 3 of Zookeeper. Starting with Solr, let's pull the official Solr Docker image. Remember to always list your version. Blindlessly pulling the latest is a great way to make sure that your system will fail in a year or two without you even needing to touch it. And give it a pretty name if you don't like random names. I'll go with Solr 1. Solr 2, and Solr 3. And maybe something creative for Zookeeper, like Zoo 1, Zoo 2, and Zoo 3. Now, let's expose ports and link them to the network. Remember, Docker has its own networking, so you have to link these up yourself. Let's link port 8981 to 8983. And on the second Solr, port 8982 to 8983. And on the third Solr, port 8983 to 8983. Now let's create a network called Solr, and, almost forgot, let's add the environment so Solr knows where Zookeeper is. Zookeeper host is Zoo1 on port 2181, and Zoo2 and Zoo3 also point to 2181. Under networks, let's add depends on, and each Solr depends on Zoo1, Zoo2, and Zoo3. Great, looking good. Now let's assign some storage. Docker is stateless, meaning the data inside of the container is lost when the container is removed. Now there are two solutions to this. You can mount a path for the container to output its data. For this, you have to create an XML file, but that's super not great. Or we can create Docker volumes, and that's exactly what we're going to do. This makes our data stateful and secure, so even if the container crashes, we don't lose that data. Now let's create volumes. And here you would add the link to Solr's var Solr path to where your data is. I'll just put this as a placeholder in the document. Now copy the environment, network, depends on, and volumes, and apply it to all of your Solr instances. And now Zookeeper, Zoo1, and then we're going to pull the image, make sure you list the version type, and we'll give the container a name, container name Zoo1. Now set a restart to always host name Zoo1. Now let's add the networking, ports 2181 and 2181, and ports 7001 to 7000. Then, following the example from the official Zookeeper Docker image, I'm going to copy and paste zoo my ID to give it an ID. And the zoo servers. Server 1 goes to 2888, 3888, 2181. And then copy and paste that for servers 2 and 3. And now some extra optional stuff. Let's whitelist some four-letter word commands, mainly monitor, config, and are you okay? And then let's add some extra configs to monitor metrics from Prometheus. And let's add this to the Solr network. Now we're going to copy and paste and change the ports on Zoo2 from 2181 to 2182 and 7001 to 7002. And the same for Zoo3, but do it with threes. Also change the zoo ID as well, which helps Zookeeper know which server is which. All right, let's double check everything to make sure that it's all good. And we are looking good. Let's go ahead and do Docker compose up. Let's jump on over to a web browser and we should be able to access Solr on port 8983. And there you go. We can now create our own cores, collections, and start running some queries. Be sure to like and subscribe as we will go through how to do all of that in another video. Check out our YouTube channel if you like tech-related videos or if you need any help. If you want to monitor this whole thing with a great tool, give Sematext Cloud a look over. Link for a free trial down in the description box below. Or if you need professional consulting, we offer some of the best consulting on the market. Check that out as well. Stay safe, and I will see you in the next video. Keep monitoring, everybody.